Would you like to learn how to go from cloud engineer to cloud architect, solutions architect, or enterprise architect? If so, this video is for you. Hi, my name's Mike Gibbs, and I'm the founder and CEO of Go Cloud Careers. And I've spent about 25 years in technology architecture, and I've spent more than two decades helping people just like you move from engineering roles to architecture roles, or get their first tech job, or get promoted in tech. And I really want to help you go from cloud engineer to cloud architecture. And cloud engineers actually have some of the best tech skills of the people working on the cloud, along with DevOps engineers. But so many times we have a DevOps engineer or a cloud engineer who wants to become a cloud architect or a solutions architect or an enterprise architect, and they really struggle. And I can tell you that after training thousands of cloud architects and seeing firsthand how the best tech people often have the hardest time going from engineering to architecture, I want to help you. And I want to help you transition faster into these architecture roles. And I also want to teach you how to capitalize on that very valuable work experience that you already have. So there's going to be four steps to success on going from cloud engineer or DevOps engineer, or even software developer to cloud architect. And they're going to be involved with regards to changing your focus from engineering tech to actual architecture, which is basically a technology to a business shift. And we'll talk about that a lot more. It's a change of job completely. See, engineering is all about building and to some degree performance tuning and optimization. And architecture is all about planning. So it's about getting the right planning skills, and we'll talk about them too. It's also going to be the way you think about technology. In engineering, we tend to love our technology, but in architecture, we can't afford to love any technology. To us, technology is just a tool to optimize our clients' business performance. And then, of course, it's branding. And I had to do it myself when I went from engineer to architect. You have to show the world that you are not such a techie, but you're more of a business executive and more of an architect. And we'll talk about that, too, because I want you to be maximally successful. So let's first talk about changing focus. As a cloud engineer, you're really tasked with building and being deeply technical on the technology. And the cloud engineer is really going to be focused on the details and focused on building the systems. But the cloud architect focus is completely different. Our focus is about tuning and optimizing the performance of our clients that we deal with, their business, much more related to aligning the organization's people, processes, and technology than it is at that engineering level of building. Because here's the reality, as cloud architects or solutions architects or enterprise architects, we no longer touch the technology, we're planning. So to be an architect, instead of thinking about how to configure the technology, you're going to have to learn the company's vision of your client, for example. You have to learn how their business operates, the type of business processes they actually have. And you have to talk to your client and understand how they want the business to operate in the future. Now, once we know the company's goals for the future, our client's goals, then we have to learn about the organization's systems and how we're going to align those people, processes, and technology, which are the magic forces for business. As architects, when you go from engineering to architect, you'll have to learn how to create new architectures that are going to be inclusive of the business's goals, not just getting the technology to work. We have to, as architects, which is a skill you'll need to learn, to understand whether the organization even has the capacity to change. Do they have the sophistication to take part in the new changes you suggest? We will have to determine the type of people that will be necessary to build the solution. So your background as an engineer will really help you there, because you're going to know what people can actually do. So that will be very helpful for you. But we're no longer building it. We're determining what kind of a team we need to actually build it and what kind of timelines we need to build the solution. Now, going from engineer to architect, you're going to have to manage a lot of stakeholders. So you're going to have to learn about that, because when you go to a client, they're going to have various business units. And each business unit is going to have different goals. And effectively, you're going to have to do this teeter-totter balance between one side of the business and another side of the business. And that means going out there, meeting the leadership, the heads of all the business units, the users of the system, getting their feedback and getting them bought in. We also, as architects, and a skill you typically need to create a governance structure. So when we actually plan an architecture, which will at some point be implemented by great cloud engineers and DevOps engineers, for example, we need to think of the overarching team that we actually need. So who do we need from the C-suite, for example? Who do we need at the VP level, for example, at the director level, at the management level, at the stakeholder level? Who are going to be the stakeholders that we have to work with? So it's learning a little bit about that. And it's also learning how to sell the solution to the client. You know, what, no matter how good our architecture is and the amount of help that our architecture can do for our client, if we can't convince the client they need it and can't convince them to buy the technologies and people that are necessary to get it to work, our architecture dies and there's no transformation, there's no change, there's no benefit. So understand your change of focus has to go from building the tech into all about optimization of the business, and the tech is now your tool to do so. Now the next phase is planning versus building. So as cloud engineers, people build things. As DevOps engineers, people build things. As architects, we don't build anything. We don't touch the technology, but we still have to plan the technology. So you have to go from building to planning. And building is completely different than planning. And that's why you see the people that build buildings, for example, aren't the people that are asked to design the buildings. The buildings are built by engineers and construction workers, but the buildings are designed by architects. So in order to do this building and planning, in order to change your focus from tech to business, you're gonna need a certain number of skills. And I'm now gonna list those key skills for you, because in most cases, your tech skills are gonna be great, but it's the business skills that are be lacking. So these are the critical skills you need to go from an engineer to an architect. The first thing is something called CXO relevancy. And what does that really mean? It means being able to relate to an executive audience, because at the end of the day, if the chief financial officer and the chief information officer and the CEO don't agree to your new design, your architecture goes nowhere. Plus, we have to ask the leadership of the organization their goals for the business. So you have to learn how to speak to the executive team, the C-suite, in the language that they speak. That's called CXO relevancy. Now, the next thing you'll need is good, strong business knowledge. As cloud architects or solutions architects or enterprise architects, our whole goal is to optimize our clients' business performance. And if you don't know business, you'll not be able to do that. So you're going to need strong business acumen skills. We teach them to our clients. You could get an MBA. It's typically cheaper and faster when we teach our clients. But, you know, you need those business acumen skills, because you can't optimize a business if you don't understand business. Now, the next set of skills you're going to need, and they're going to need very strong leadership skills, because for the most part, in most big architectures, you're going to have to lead a team of 15 to 50 people for the next 6 to 12 months to understand all of the client's business goals and all the business processes and understand how they want it to work in the future. For example, if I'm going to do a big cloud architecture, I'm going to have to build a team of the following: network architects, application architects, security architects, potentially artificial intelligence architects, data scientists, data engineers, cloud engineers, DevOps engineers, and even software developers, because the engineers are going to be more technical and the architects are going to be bigger picture. I need both to create a beautiful architecture. So you're going to need leadership skills of these populations. Now, the next is stakeholder management skills. If you can't convince the people that are in charge of big parts of the business to get on board, they won't adopt the architecture, they won't adopt the technology project, and it'll fail. We also need those stakeholders to help sell our solution, which brings us to sales skills. Sales are so important for the architect. First, they will affect your compensation in a great way. In many of these top architecture roles, principal architect roles, there's about $200,000 difference between the top paid person and the bottom paid person on the team. And that's usually related to the amount of products you can sell, solutions you can sell, and how well you can sell yourself in the interview. So get good sales skills. Not only is it necessary to get hired, but the better your sales skills are, the faster you'll get promoted and the more money you will earn in your career. And I want the best for you. You're also going to need strong communication skills. You know, in engineering, somebody may give you a piece of paper and say, build this. Not always. Sometimes you got to ask a lot of questions, but you'll be given something. As an architect, we don't even know where to begin until we start asking our clients questions. So you will need strong communication skills to get the information from your client. You will need strong communications to build and lead the team that you need. You will need strong communication skills to promote team harmony on your team, and you're just going to need strong communication skills. Communication skills are like the old programming saying, garbage in, garbage out. If your communication skills can't get you the right information, you'll never get to the right diagnosis, and your plan will be off. Now, presentation skills. You know, when I was an engineer, I didn't give a lot of presentations. When I became an architect, wow, I gave presentations almost every day. This is absolutely so critical to be able to present, because you're constantly going to be presenting to clients, presenting at conferences, presenting at executive briefings, that kind of thing when you're an architect. So you're going to need that. And guess what? You know the last part of a cloud architect interview or a solutions architect interview or an enterprise architect interview is typically a presentation to a board of people. So let's get your presentation skills in tip-top shape. It'll raise your salary and make you more desirable to the client. Now, the next skill is called executive presence. You need to be able to walk in and command a room. If I turned off my executive presence and said, "Hi, my name is Mike Gibbs and I'm the CEO of GoCloud Careers," nobody's going to listen to me with power. But if I said, "Hi, everyone, this is Mike Gibbs. I'm the CEO of GoCloud Careers. How can I help you?" That difference of the executive presence is there. So make sure you really work on your executive presence. You know, we teach it to our clients. Actually, we teach all these skills to our clients. But if you're not with us, get an executive coach. Get some people that can teach you how to better present. Get some executive presence. Now, the next thing is vendor management. Let's face it, you know, 98% of clients use more than one cloud, so they're all hybrid and hybrid multi-cloud solutions. But I might have some security products from, say, Cisco or Palo Alto Networks. I may have a SIEM system from another organization inside of my systems. I may have a database from Oracle, and I may be using a Mongo database, and I may have a lot of vendors to manage. So you're going to have strong vendor management skills when you pull all these pieces and parts together in your cloud architectures and your enterprise architectures. Now, you will need to have a good level of emotional intelligence, because you're going to be leading teams for a long period of time. You may be leading as an architect, you may be leading a bunch of engineers through a complicated proof of concept kind of testing. You will be managing large teams. And when you work on hard projects, times get tough. So you'll need to have that emotional intelligence to diffuse situations and make the team happy and keep people from arguing with each other and keep them productive. So you'll need to train that. And the last of the real skills here is negotiation skills. Nobody really wakes up and says, "I'm going to spend this much money today," but you will be constantly negotiating with internal stakeholders, external stakeholders, even negotiating, you know, when you're actually in a deal, you know, for certain things you can or can't do with a client. So negotiation's there. But as a bonus, when you develop your negotiation skills, you'll earn more because you'll be able to better negotiate your job offer. So now let's talk about the tech training. Now, to be fair, cloud engineers shine here. DevOps engineers shine here. But there's usually some gaps, and I'm going to talk to you about that. Engineers have the best technical skills when it's related to building the systems. They are very focused and have deep knowledge and are great at automating, great at tuning. You know, lots of respect and love for engineers coming from me. But architecture is more about how the components actually work and how they fit together. The example I like to use is, let's talk about the CPU in a server. The CPU selection, maybe we had a private cloud. In engineering, it's all about building that system, but as the architect, I may need to look at the CPU in that system. I may need to understand how many PCIe lanes that has and how many GPUs I can pop into that server for, say, machine learning. I may be looking at the server's level 1, level 2, and level 3 cache to determine how that's going to work when we get into an oversubscription scenario in a virtual machine environment, which is common in cloud computing. I may have to think about the core to DRAM communication and how those cores interact with each other. So in one place, the architect is thinking about how the technology works and how the parts fit together. And in another case, we've got an engineer that's really great at hands-on building. So you have to change the way you think about your tech training. It's going to be all about how the underlying technology works. How does that networking technology work? How does that firewall actually work? What is that firewall doing, not only from a stateful perspective, but if it finds a anomaly type behavior, what can it do about it? Does it have any AI that can look for anomaly patterns? How does a packet go through that firewall? If we've got new messages coming into that firewall, can it spin up a virtual machine on demand and test the code, for example? We really need to get into a deep understanding of how the tech works. So how the tech works and how the techs fit together. If you've only been building, you may have to get a little training here. For example, how would you design your demilitarized zone versus how would you configure the firewall? And the last piece is branding. And I had to work really hard for this when I went from engineer to architect many years ago, about 25 years ago. The key here is that the architect is an executive, and they're paid as an executive. And they expect you to look, walk, and talk like an executive while still having good tech skills. the engineer is the best techie out there. They're amazing. I love engineers. But when they hire an architect, they're looking for a business executive, not a techie. So you have to show yourself as a business executive in the way that you speak, in the way that you carry yourself, and even the way you talk about technology. So you need to show that leadership skills, that business knowledge, and excellent communication skills. You need to be able to show that you can sell and write a persuasive document or an article. And you need to show that you are focused on improving business outcomes, not the tech itself. That you don't love any particular kind of tech, you love making your clients successful. Now, if you take these tips that I've given you and you learn these things that I'm telling you, you will get incredible architecture roles. And like I said, I've trained people that are nurses and sales reps, and it takes me about a year to get them a cloud architect job, 6 months to a year for their first job. And I've trained engineers, and it typically takes 6 to 12 months. But let me tell you, when you go from an engineering background, you've got that engineering experience, and you can show yourself as that business executive, the offers you get in terms of salary are incredibly high, much higher than the average. So leverage your skills, capitalize on your skills, and turn yourself into an architect. Now, if you'd like to learn how to get your first enterprise architect job, cloud architect job, solutions architect job, AI architect job, or security architect job, join us for one of our free webinars. Also, in the description of this video, there are so many free resources that can help you in your architecture career. So check them out. They're all free. If you've enjoyed this video, please give it a like, subscribe, and hit the bell to be notified of new videos to help you in your technology career. This is Mike Gibbs signing off for now, and I look forward to seeing you in another video or a free webinar live on Zoom.